everything.
Yeah. Remember I what I was just saying about communication?
Good evening, yeah. Everyone. The board has been in executive session, and I would like to move that we resume our regular session. Is there
take a motion.
Take a motion. Second. Is there a second? All in favor?
Aye.
This is the regular meeting of the Planning Board of the Village of Dobbs Ferry on November 4. We have 7 items on the agenda. Before we get to the agenda, there's a few housekeeping things I'd like to mention. For the past several months, after Mr. Plotkin's retirement, our alternate, Alan Hale, has been a voting member of the board. In the code, the chair has, in the absence of a regular member, the ability to name the alternate as a voting member, and we've been delighted to have Mr. Hale voting with us officially for the last several months. Thank you. Also, I'd like to acknowledge correspondence that we've received during this past month. Suzanne Sanzow, Bruce Richards, Stephen Tilley, Vincent Fecchio, Peggy Blizzard, and Judith Spikes have all sent either emails or snail mails to us regarding various things, I think in this case all regarding 75 Main Street, and we appreciate your interest. I think we will move to the agenda. The first item on the agenda is the adoption of the minutes of the Planning Board for October 8. I have reviewed them and had no comment. Does anyone have comments or additions, corrections? Then I would move their adoption. Is there a second? All in favor? Thank you. The second item on the agenda is the referral from the Board of Trustees to amend site plan approval for cinema roof parking relocation to sub-basement at Rivertown Square Project.
Chairman, if I could just remind everyone to speak into the microphone, including board members and everyone that is coming up to the microphone, to state their name and address and talk into the microphone.
Yeah, thank you.
Good evening. My name is Susan Burke. I'm with Sabre Real Estate Advisors. I'm here to answer any questions you have about the material that was submitted. I know Mr. Palmer had some questions about the landscaping and the life safety, so I have additional paperwork that I can hand out.
George, maybe you can just tell just quickly what the proposal is for the public and for the board to change.
Sure. The applicant has come in and they're taking the rooftop parking that was on the cinema and what was on top of the cinema, and they're now putting it underneath the cinema in the basement level. The reason for the change was mostly building aesthetics and structural, from what I understand. And the convenience to move things under. It was easier to construct.
Correct.
It avoided certain other complications.
Correct. It made it much easier to build.
Much easier to build. So, and in doing that, they've eliminated the lights that were on the roof and the issues that come along with parking on the roof, which is the headlights shining everywhere and whatnot.
Microphone.
So, all in all, we spoke to the landscape architect, Lucille Munns, and she agreed that it was also a good change. It was a positive change for the project.
I'm just curious, how are they getting in and out? How are you getting in and out of that level? Off of what, like, because before, how did you get to the, how were they getting to the roof before?
The parking garage behind the building had a ramp going from the second level to the cinema rooftop. Now that ramp has just been changed within that same parking structure to be going down and up.
Could you elaborate a little bit on what one would see on top of the roof instead of parking?
The same thing that was there without parking, so there'll be the rooftop units and that's it.
Which will be screened.
Which will be the same. There's no change in any of that. It's just the parking is gone and the lighting is gone.
Yeah.
And the ramp is gone from Ogden Avenue.
But materials are the same and
everything's the same.
Well, actually, the concrete roof would probably change to a membrane roof, the typical standard.
Yes.
So you wouldn't see the concrete anymore. You'd see a typical membrane, which would be a black or a white or whatever.
And whatever screening of mechanical things would take, would be whatever we've agreed to for the rest of the project.
What was there before is still going to remain. It was roughly a 10-foot high parapet wall type screening, so that's going to remain.
Was there ever discussion about converting it to a green roof?
Yeah.
George, was that in, that was not mentioned by the landscape architect?
No, it wasn't. Only that, the same issue that you mentioned, that the mechanical units stay screened. As far as turning it to a green roof, that wasn't ever in a resolution or anything. If they opted to do that, or you requested that they entertain that opportunity, if they do, then you can do that.
I think visually this is an improvement. As I recall, this roof is visible from Ogden Avenue up above and as you come down, so it's important that that roof, you know, have, be as attractive as possible.
Right, well, now we've eliminated all the lighting, so that was the original problem with the lighting, so that's all.
Now, there are a few engineering issues that need to be finalized with you, George, which is typical.
Yeah, there's some of the, placing it under the building, they're going to have to address drainage, any ancillary drainage from, let's say, a sprinkler or any water that might get in there. They have to address access and so forth. So anything that comes with putting it under the building, they have to address it. But it's typical. It's not
complicated. That's all been done by the architect.
The architect. And I believe Tony Wan has looked at it from a life safety issue as well. So.
Is he okay with it?
He was okay with, I believe he was okay with the changes.
Okay, so I think we'll have to have the chief to make sure that's okay. Fire chief. So what you can do tonight is, it's a minor change, actually probably a good change from what it sounds like,
yeah.
Is recommend a waiver of site plan approval to the Board of Trustees contingent upon finalization of the engineering by the HON engineering and a sign off by the fire department.
Yep. So moved. Any other discussion by the board?
Is there a second?
I didn't catch a second. No, not yet.
Okay.
All in favor? Unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Item 3 on the agenda this evening is a continuation of the public hearing for site plan review to the Board of Trustees for proposed alterations and additions on property located at 75 Main Street.
Good evening. My name is Seth Mandelbaum, the law firm of McCullough, Goldberger, and Stout. I've been retained by the contract vendee for the 75 Main Street property with respect to this project. Bart Vlad is the principal of BRB Contracting LLC. I understand this has been before you on referral from the Board of Trustees for a couple of meetings now. And been getting myself up to speed the last few weeks. Visited the site and working with the development team on the land use and zoning issues in particular, which I understand will be a big part of the discussion this evening. It's really a sort of threshold issue. Since you've already seen this a few times, I'm not going to get into too much detail regarding the project. I think you're all familiar with it. As an adaptive reuse of the iconic Oceana Publishing Building on the corner of Main and Chestnut. It is, we believe, completely aligned with the intent of the vision plan as incorporated into your zoning to bring mixed-use redevelopment projects into the downtown in a transit-oriented development close to the train station, trying to preserve the historic nature of the downtown and get those sought-after millennials and empty nesters living downtown, and certainly something that your code is strongly encouraging and is giving you and the Board of Trustees a lot of flexibility. So what we've done is a few things since the last couple of meetings is trying to respond to technical comments, and that would be on several different topics, traffic and parking, socioeconomic, stormwater, scenic views, et cetera. And you have several different reports prepared by experts retained by the applicant. Rather than bringing each expert up to the microphone to summarize their reports, They are here this evening if there are any particular questions that the board has on any conclusion, whether it be regarding the net benefit to the tax base or the 30 off-street parking spaces and, you know, getting those cars off the street, the various disciplines. We have them here, so they're happy to answer any questions, but we thought it would be more useful and more relevant to what the board is looking at to really focus on the fact that this is a unique site in that it's split zoning. On the Main Street side, it's DB, it's MDR2 as you go down the hill for Palisade, and that leads to some interesting decisions for the Board of Trustees ultimately, but of course this board making that recommendation. And we've asked this board to consider rezoning the back portion of the property from Chestnut and Palisade to DB to make the site one consistent zoning district. And along with that, you have a lot of flexibility to grant waivers or modifications where it meets the intent of the code and where, of course, you and the Board of Trustees deem it appropriate. The reason, one of the many reasons we requested the zone change was to make those waivers less numerically significant. I think it's important to keep in mind that the building itself, particularly the front building, is a legally non-conforming building over the coverage and the height that would be allowed if you tried to build it from scratch now. And the part of the back, the warehouse structure as you go down to the Palisade in the MDR2 is non-conforming, but is much less so if you're rezoned to DB. So with that, I'd like to bring out Patty Steinschneider to give you a bit of an overview on some of the viewpoints. And then I think my understanding is, from talking to Darius and staff, that the board really would like to focus on what Javier suggested we looked at last time. You know, what is an as-of-right situation in the MDR2? And frankly, why we, the many different reasons why we believe the rezoning and the design we propose with the step back as you go up the building above the proposed garage is a better solution from a design perspective, but also is more in line with what the code is strongly encouraging as far as this part of the downtown. So I appreciate your time. Patty, you can take me through.
Patty Steinstein, Gotham Design Community Development. We're going to try and be relatively quick because I'm sure you've got other stuff. Basically, really quickly, here's the site showing you know, how this sets in to the village. I think you're all familiar with it. The building is right here. This is from your code. It's the platforms for public viewing, and the one that's an issue is here, but a view from that shows that it really doesn't have it, that what we're proposing has no impact on that. We do have impacts in a couple of places. This is the elevation. This is from the corner, and you see the massing back here. You're blocking sky from the view on Main Street. Here is the view from the next door house. This is their backyard. This is the outline, if you will, of the addition that would be above the existing warehouse. One thing I want to point out is these trees all remain, and they're on this side of that mass. So where you can see the white line going across the trees, the reality is they would be behind the trees. Same thing looking this way. This is the portion of the building you can see between the bank and the existing structure. Those trees are towards the street. So those would be remain, and they would block the view of the building. This is looking from the aqueduct, where you can see the addition behind the front building. Since the last meeting, we finally got our survey all put together. It had a slight surprise for us, which has had an impact on us reducing the size of what we're proposing in the back. The property is not actually straight. It kind of bends at this point, and what that does is it makes a difference of a couple of feet in what we thought the width of the building was. So we've made all the modifications to that. Really quickly taking you through, this was drawings that I think you've gotten PDFs. We're going to be submitting all of this next week in hard form, along with all the reports formally. Basically just ground floor parking with a total of 16 spaces. Floor above, floor below was accessed off of Palisade Street. This is accessed off of Chestnut. There's a courtyard here between the front building and the back building, which will be the entrance for all of the units in the building. That's where the elevator and stairs will be. Here is showing the massing as it's been cut back through previous meetings. That's something that ARPOD will be able to address in detail tonight. This is just an outline so that you can see what it is. Important is this is the mezzanine level where we're proposing a pool and common areas. That's what actually lines up with the brick parapet on the back, which is below the pitched roof. The height that we've got here of the 1, 2, 3 stories above the existing base, that actually lines up with the bottom of the windows on the existing building. So it definitely steps back, steps in. One of the ideas of stepping this, which in addition to cutting a substantial amount of mass, is it also gives a nice relationship to the church across the street. We have no shadows at this point on the church, which I think is a good goal. We don't really need to go into any of the details on this stuff other than just to say that the concerns that were expressed at the previous meeting were that we were going to need to do all the construction out in the street, and we'd have piled materials and vehicles and everything else. What we've done is we've worked it through that we can do most of the work on the interior using that garage area. So we've shown the stockpile for soil, the stockpile for the concrete, a material storage area, a equipment storage area, and then dumpsters on the interior of the building where we'll be able to get rid of the organics, the wood and everything that we're tearing off from above. I think that's just the point. I think that'll make it better for the neighbors. We're not going to go into any details with any of the drainage. This building, technically, the site coverage is what it is. There's no drainage now, drainage provisions for stormwater now. We are providing the ideas of three different things. First, detaining water on site with basins that we would locate below the garage floor. Second, a blue roof on the mezzanine deck level, and a green roof on top of the mezzanine itself. So there will be a reduction in the volume of water during peak storm events that will be beneficial to the village. This is one of those locations where with all the water coming downhill, it operates at a pretty high capacity. This is just landscaping, which shows that there are existing trees that are primarily on the neighbor's properties. We're now 15 to 16 feet away from those. Some concerns that were expressed earlier that we would be somehow undermining the roots of those trees and losing those trees, I don't think that's an issue. We have proposed planting a series of street trees along both Chestnut and Palisades, which I think would be a nice improvement. Okay, here's where it gets a little bit more interesting. What we're dealing with is the idea of, it was actually a request made by members of the planning board that we take a look at what this property could be. If we just ignored the front building, took a look at this being an MDR2 zone for the back building, and what would prove out with what we could basically build there. So what we've shown is a four-story building, four-level building, three stories, with a total of 8 residential units, with the height of the building to the midpoint of the roof 40 feet, which is code. At that point, the ridge is 56'3" above the curb, but of course, these measurements would be taken from the grade plane as the code basically lays it out. The units, the 8 units in this building are not limited by what the zoning permits in terms of a density number, because if you took the site area and divided it by 800 square feet, which is the requirement, you'd actually get 14 units. But we're limited by the fact that you're only allowed a certain amount of site coverage, both in the building and in the parking lot. So what the lowest common denominator turns out to be parking. So what we've done is we've shown the maximum number of parking spaces on the site, which is 7, with the idea that we'd be creating 3 additional curbside spaces that exist now for a total of 10. Total of 10 parking spaces covers the requirement for a non-mixed-use building for 8 units. So that's what the basis of that is.
And the front and parking for the front unit?
there will be no parking for the front unit. But at that point, the difference in this is fairly, I mean, maybe I should go into some of the detail on it. This would be eliminating the warehouse structure, so you would not be creating a parking garage. You would have no parking for the front building. This would be a lesser price point, if you will, in terms of what the use of the building would turn out to be, in addition to reducing taxes, all that. It would mean that you'd probably be operating this as a rental property, with maybe 16 to 18 units in the front building, with the 8 units in the back. Because you don't have parking for the front building, you're really limited to rental at that point with smaller units. What we're hoping to do is if we can have parking with the adaptation of the first, you know, the existing garage structure or existing warehouse structure into a garage, that gives us 28 parking spaces. And that 28 parking spaces, that makes the front building viable for condominium ownership as well as the back units. So with a total of 28 plus the net 2 that we get on the street, we have one additional curb cut from the 3, we've got 30 parking spaces where if we're going 24 units, we're required to have 24. So we meet that requirement. When we were talking about this earlier, we kind of got into some of the numbers with this. With the MDR2 version of this, we would end up with about 12,000 square feet of floor area for the 8 units. With what we're proposing for the use of the 3 stories above the parking garage structure, that would be a total of approximately 16,500 square feet in 10 units. So you would actually have 2 additional units, but you would have, you know, you'd have basically 4,500 square feet additional space. So the units are larger, more prone to something you could put on the market and sell, and I think that would work out well. Okay, I think we don't really want to go into detail with any of the stuff in the reports. What I'll do is maybe just kind of list out what we have either already submitted to you or what you'll be getting. There was a traffic and parking report that I prepared, which you got several weeks ago. Since then, we have had a, you guys appreciate, we've had a real traffic engineer do it. We've had Charles Hope from TRC take a look at it, and what Charles has come up with is that we would be, if we went in and occupied the existing building for its existing permitted uses, we'd be looking at a certain volume of traffic and parking. If we compare what the IPE books give for what we're proposing, we would be reducing the net trips between 30 and 50 trips, depending on which peak hour that you pick. So a significant reduction with the proposed from using the existing building as its current use. That becomes perhaps more significant when we address parking, because of course we're proposing parking. If we go in and we reactivate the building as its current use, as you know what that could be with its 18,000 square feet, the parking that would result from that, since we wouldn't be providing any, would be 33 spaces on weekdays, 38 spaces on Fridays, and 42 spaces on Saturdays. So significant impact on parking if you reuse the existing building in its current use.
Is that actually a feasible thing to do?
To get operated for decades, or 100 years.
But it hasn't done that for a decade.
I don't think you're going to get...
Just curious, I mean, because you're comparing it to something that well, is not happening.
Okay, and this is probably underlying a lot of the conversations that really needs to take place on this. Is it viable? Sure. Would you be making, you know, what would your rents be? You know, if you're not providing parking, your rent's going to be much less.
No, I mean, realistically, it's a commercial building, basically, right? So is somebody going to move in into that and use it as a commercial
sure.
building? I'm just curious.
So I understand what you're asking.
Yeah.
I think.
I mean, it's
a good way to think of it is in an EIS when you do a no action alternative, you sort of project out growth if you did nothing or used the site for what it's traditionally been used for. Mm-hmm. For seeker purposes, that's really the baseline for comparison.
Yes.
I understand what you're saying. Is it rentable?
Is it realistic? Is that a realistic comparison?
But that's the baseline that the traffic engineer is going to use for providing that delta between if you just used it for what it's permitted versus reusing it for something else. That's what I understand you're saying, is it real?
Yeah, is somebody actually going to have another publishing company there? I don't think so.
Right, you have to have a baseline to compare, otherwise the numbers are just sort of inaccurate.
Okay, thanks.
So that's why the traffic engineer did this.
Yeah, I just realized I was showing you an earlier version of that, and I do have the photo from the top looking down on Chestnut Street. So that is the view from the view shed. You can see the building down on the right-hand side. With all these, unfortunately, because these images are much better to look at. Didn't know why it was so washed out. So going back to this slide, David Smith is here this evening. David, you may remember from Rivertown Square. He's prepared a socioeconomic report, and I think two interesting points that David has on in those two is that the proposed project would generate approximately, it would double the taxes that the village would be getting with no increase based on that with additional services the village is giving. So the tax income would be very beneficial. It also has $1.1 million of anticipated local expenditures of disposable income for the residents. Can't guarantee it'll get spent up ferry, but it's the those people living in this area would be spending money, restaurants, stores, you know, those kinds of places. We also have, we have an engineer working on the storm drainage. So that's, Paul Berte will be addressing that. You'll have that in your packets for next time. And I think the only other thing we have of those things is that I've already hit the national, or the natural and the scenic views, you know, the impacts we have on that. You should have gotten a fairly long report that goes into great detail with lots and lots of photos. I didn't want to bore you to death showing you that. So, you know, if you have questions, you know, ask me, but I think it speaks for itself. The other thing that we're looking to do tonight is get into the historic rehabilitation aspects of it. Arpad is here, he's an expert in that. So what we'd like to do is have Arpad come up and talk to you about what his vision is for this and how this deals with being a historic structure. Because of course, there have been claims that this is on the register, it turns out it's apparently not. There were never tax credits that were given for this, so there are issues with that, which Arpad can obviously address a lot better than I can. And then maybe talk a little bit about the massing changes. Now, okay. You talk about whatever you want. That's how about I said that.
Good evening, Arpad Buckshot, the applicant, the architect for the applicant. I just talked to you about, everyone's talking about historic tax credits. So I'll just cut to the chase. The renovation I talk about, you know, pointing, cleaning, repair, I've talked about every time it came up. So historic tax credits. The intent of the building is to become a condominium. In order to make historic tax credits worthwhile, it has to be an income-producing property. Condominiums are not income-producing property because people live in it. So you would buy it for yourself as if it were a house. So you're not making money on your house. Okay, so that's one. So what's left? The commercial space. So to get this tax credit takes 9 months to a year, assuming everything goes wonderfully. We've already talked to Higgins and Crisbart. They're nationally renowned preservation consultants. And basically, on back of envelope, it works out that by the time the applicant pays for them, me, etc., fees, it's about a wash. So historic tax credits are not really realistic for this project. And they don't, by the way, whoever said someone did it, it never happened because we checked that. So that's it.
Thanks. So, you know, that's our basic presentation for this evening. As I said, my introduction, we have all of our experts here, and we'd like to focus on whatever questions the board has at this point. And of course, I understand it's a public hearing, I'm sure we'll hear from the public as well. But you know, we see this, as on other projects I've worked on that were referrals from the Board of Trustees. We want to get the board to a point where we've addressed your concerns and you're comfortable with the recommendation that you're making to the Board of Trustees. So we want to understand what we need to do to get you to the point where you're ready to make that recommendation. And my client, like all contract vendees and like all developers, wants that to happen 3 months ago. But all we ask is that the process move along in a reasonable and fair way, and we feel that's been happening, and we want to continue that conversation to get to a point where hopefully you're comfortable doing that in the near future. So that's really where we are, and we're here at your disposal to talk about whatever you'd like.
I don't know if the rest of the members got RPAD's report in their package. Did you get? And this is number two on your list of stuff. Did you submit that, or is it?
It's been submitted, but it has. I don't think it's made it into the package.
Okay, so.
And I can send. I'll send all the board.
No, but I was just wondering if the public might be interested in some of those aspects.
Oh, well, it'll be filed.
Okay, so there's no hurry.
And if there's anything specific you'd like them to address, that's why he's here.
Okay.
Chair, before you take comments, I know the board has a lot. Why don't you open the public hearing formally? Have the board comment or public comment on the meeting?
Okay, I would move that we. This is a continuation of the public hearing, so I move that we continue the public hearing. Is there a second? All in favor? Good. Well, I think first comments from the board, and then we'll try to have an opportunity for the public to speak briefly.
Can I ask for clarification? The building has moved back. We've eliminated the balconies and so forth. And you mentioned in the past that basically there's additional setbacks from the side property, the adjacent residence. So if you can clarify, and I think at one point the Chestnut Street side was further back. Is that correct?
Thank you. Talk in the microphone, please.
Okay. Sorry. At one point early on, we had looked at this setting back from Chestnut Street. What we've done is we've pulled it to Chestnut Street. I mean, it's a specific decision that Arpad made. It's not, oh, we can get some space. His feeling, which I do not disagree, I think is actually very good, and our response from the ARB was also very favorable, that by pulling that forward, what we were doing is we're really creating the street wall going down Chestnut. So it brings that in a good way. The concern before was that we had these floors continuing out, kind of so that it squared with that, and then we had balconies that projected further from that. So all of those have been cut back. We've got a 10-foot setback already with the existing building. There's a 10-foot setback then to the to part of this with further erosion, more pyramidal or ziggurat, if you will. And then it sets back again on the third floor. Am I supposed to say ziggurat?
That's the word.
Okay, I don't say that anymore. So it sets back on the third floor and then again on the mezzanine. The mezzanine level is set back 50 feet from Palisade Street. So this isn't like a couple of feet. It's fairly significant and substantive. And the mezzanine also sets back from the sides. So it's designed in a way that you'll probably be able to notice there's something there, but it won't be part of your facade. The building will really look like it's a three-story structure on top of this base, which of course, as the report that I submitted to you went into some detail on, that's actually really, it's a condition that is very common on Palisade Street. If you look at the five Palliser houses that are built on that kind of promenade, that's a large retaining wall that actually gets to be about the same height as our base. And then the buildings are set back from that, and you've got 3 to 4 stories of buildings setting up on top of that. So if you start to look at that massing, it's probably a bit taller and more substantive than what we're showing. So it's not anomaly.
Patty, I want to thank you for doing the SketchUp models. They're incredibly useful and helpful. Do you have an updated SketchUp model for this new form?
Not for tonight, I don't think. I mean, first of all, do you want to?
Just because at some point, I'd love to see the perspective on the SketchUp models as if you're standing at the doorway at Pompeii and looking up at it.
Is there anything before I take this off? Anything else?
Yeah, if you could, so that exercise that you did of the, we'll call it as of right. I think you had a 17. Foot back, setback on the. Are you listening, Patty?
Let me answer his. what we did is we have here 17 foot from.
Our pod hasn't.
Sorry. We need those little lapel things. That'd be easier. What we've got is a 17 foot setback here, which is the prevailing along the street. It's actually not really the prevailing, it's the prevailing of the two houses next door. As you go further along the street, within the 200 foot distance, there's actually buildings that are even closer. So we could bring that up closer. What we've done is we've matched that 17 feet, which is 7 feet more than what the existing building does. But of course, we've also got 7 foot porches in front, which we're permitted to have in the zoning district. And so the distance setback is about the same 10. So this is similar. This is 16 feet, which is just about what we've got now with the existing building. The difference is on Chestnut, because we've set back in here 10 feet to the property line and an additional 7 feet. So we're 10 feet to the deck or the porch and then 17 feet to the building. But in my opinion, setting back there is not something that's really great for the character of the street, streetscape. And this parking lot is actually out of the vision plan as the recommended. We said that if you're going to do a parking lot, don't put it here, don't put it here, put it here or here. So it's doing what it's supposed to do. My personal feeling is that this would be unfortunate on the street.
Right,
and
we're not
having this building would be much better.
We're not talking the merits of this, only, you know, what it is. So now for the neighbor's house.
This one?
Yes, relative to what is the as-of-right build-out. You're going, that wall that faces them is how high?
That wall would be 28 feet from
to
the
eave.
Grade plane. So maybe 35, 36 feet.
And then to the eave?
That's to the eave. And that's the height of the wall itself, not the, if you're looking at the total height, this height to the ridge would be 56 foot three in the as of right, which is compared to, I think we're around 58 feet. It's about 2 foot six lower than what our top is to our third floor on top of the parking garage. But of course, with this, you don't have the parking garage issue with the base and all that. You don't have the mass in that building. That would go away. You'd be able to see the backside of, 75 Main Street much better. it would be opened up. Not passing judgment, obviously, you'd be able to see it better. Obviously, landscaping, other things would be able to be done, but I don't think there's any comparison between these two. And to me, if we're getting somewhere around 4,000 square feet more to make this, our proposal, viable, and if the offset to getting that 4,000 square feet to make our proposal viable...
From 12,000 to 16,000?
Right. If what we're doing is getting that 4,000 square feet, which makes it viable, and if our total number of units is, say, somewhere between 22 and 24 units, versus what would turn out to be probably 24 units. So it's really not a difference in number of units. The units in the MDR2 version would be smaller, they would be rental, but you would lose the parking. So there would be no parking for the front building. And you would also lose that economic driver that the proposed project has, which includes into it a fairly substantial amount of money for the rehabilitation of the existing structure. I think you'd be approaching this building very differently. You'd be looking to make it a rental property. Something in my office, in a kind of very unwitting way, referred to it, which would be, Mercy Dorm South. So, the idea of this becoming all rental apartments, I do not think would be a better concept, even if it meant that this massing was smaller.
That's subjective, but I think it's very helpful for the board and for the audience to see what, because we talk a lot about the current zoning and why don't we follow the current zoning, and this is at least one example of what the current zoning would permit.
Can we have sketch up? That's what Michael said.
Chestnut Street.
Everyone can see us? Okay, from Chestnut, we step back, we step back again, we step back again, like this. In addition, when you see it from Palisade Street, it steps back, goes up, steps back. So it's a ziggurat, I mean, it is a ziggurat.
It's not bad, that's, I mean, it's, that's not a bad thing.
No, no, it's not bad. It's just, it's become a joke with us. So it starts, so it steps back in two different directions. I think that's the question.
No, it was actually in the SketchUp model where you can do sort of a point of view from eye level. What would that would look like if you rotate the building and you're standing at the front door of Pompeii? Just curious as to, because it's really hard to
That's diagonally across.
Mm-hmm.
So you can, so wait, okay. You see it step back here, you can see it step in again, one floor
but it, up. Is it interactive that you can sort of get to Pompeii? They're just screenshots.
I do.
But you have that viewpoint, right? From what you're saying, right from the church front door?
Yes.
We have the SketchUp model, so we can move it.
Oh, okay. Is that actually in the package, or? I don't think
yes,
I saw it.
It should be. It's always been.
Maybe I missed
it. I don't know if it's in the packet, but
there are a bunch of screenshots.
Kind of, we need these thumb drives. I don't think we have them.
Yeah.
Okay.
We need them.
You want
them?
There we go. You're going to get it.
Okay.
Okay. This one, you can see that. So push it down. So, I mean, it's really obvious in this one. So street. So that's corner view. Steps back 10 feet. This is back 10. I think it's back 8 or 9 feet. I don't want to misspeak. On both sides, okay, this facade goes up 2 floors, again steps back 10 feet, mm-hmm. steps in 10 feet at the top, so again.
But you can you get it down to ground level? So is it the perspective, I'm looking for the perspective of ground level looking up. I think that would be very informative. Do you think this is useful? We're wasting everybody's time.
It's incredible.
The whole thing down on the sheet. Now go to that and rotate down. Yep.
Oop, you're up. There you go. Now maybe just rotate around to Pompeii. I'm trying to get a sense of how much the upper floors disappear when you're at eye level.
When you're
on eye level. Can you rotate around just to the count? Yeah, there we go. You're still a little bit high. That's about right. Great, thank you. That's about what I was looking for, yeah.
Thanks.
Good, thank you. Well, I think one of the most interesting thing for me tonight was the work you did on showing what under the current zoning what would be one, at least one of the possibilities of building out that site, and what the implications, at least for your client, what the implications would be for the front building and so for the project as a whole. which I think makes, you know, there's a contrast, and I think that's important for us to see and for the public to see. I think it might be helpful for the board if we could have another work session with the applicant at some point between now and the next meeting, such that we could. Would that be possible?
You know the answer. Whatever you want. You know, yeah, we'd love to have another work session with you.
Okay.
You know, whatever is good.
Yeah.
I don't have the 6.5 hour driver's course this Saturday, so this Saturday will be fine.
Well, maybe we can think of a date. It is a public hearing. Are you done with your presentation for this evening?
I think we're done with the presentation. We're just, if we're available, questions.
I mean, we have the consultant here for the socioeconomic point of view, and you said something that basically there'll be no additional drain on village services and so forth. I'd just like to hear a little more about kind of a quick recap from them.
Good evening, Dave Smith, Planning and Development Advisors. Our initial evaluation of the proposed project was to generate the economic impacts of the proposed project. Perhaps Patty got a little bit ahead of himself. We didn't get into detail with respect to specific drain on services, but this is an existing facility, it's an existing building. You have existing services that plow the streets, pick up the trash. So we're not expecting that this is going to be a heavy user of municipal services at all. This would be a fairly conventional development that we would find in a downtown urban setting.
Can you speak a little bit to the retail portion? Obviously, there's been a lot of focus on this massing and this side of the development, but you know the other part would have a significant impact, I think, on Main Street.
As far as the
the type of retail and how that would operate and what you know kind of parking requirements that would generate and so forth.
Well, the I think the issue with respect to the retail, we don't have specific users that would occupy the particular space at this point. I think that the issue that we tried to focus on is that the retail component is going to generate some tax revenue to the village. It'll be an economic generator with respect to jobs, and it will help round out and fill in some of the vacancies that we have on Main Street right now. But again, you've got existing space that's vacant, and the intention is to fill that. I think the other aspect that we wanted to focus on is that with the 24 households that would occupy the proposed project, each of those brings some level of disposable income if it is spent within the downtown area. And I think that was important for us to identify to the village that with the price points that are contemplated here, you're going to have folks that have fairly substantial incomes. And I think the expectation is that they're going to spend some measure of their income, restaurants, shops, right here in downtown Dallas Fair. And that was the whole intention, to kind of point that out and illustrate that aspect of the proposed project.
All right, thank you.
Anyone else? If we'll be able to ask questions later if we wish. It is a public hearing, and if there are people that wish to speak, if this is the time to do it, I would say that many of the, if you've spoken before and if we have heard your views, unless it's on some different subject, I would appreciate brevity tonight. That would be helpful. Repetitiveness does not necessarily serve any particular purpose. But that said, does anyone wish to? Mr. Richards.
Oh, Bruce Richards, Main Street, part of it. The applicants have been citing an 1895 version of a mercantile building as the reason that if we had the back view shown up again. They based their whole design on this sort of mercantile post and lintel squared off, similar to 100 Main's facade premise. And yet, if this is more of a situation for HRB, there's an 1865 photograph of the building which shows its original usage, which was also a grain store, but it's only a two-story tall building. So if they're going to redo the front of the building to meet this 1895 building, they also might consider having to take off the top two stories because the verbiage that's being used, that they were to remove all the non-historic infill. This is very important. If you put this last slide of the back of the building up and compare it to the front end of the dog, it doesn't even come close to looking like anything that is a neoclassical structure that is there now. And I think this is really important on the size, the massing, and everything else that's been considered by this board, that basically has to do a dance with the HRB deciding, number one, what is the historical point at which we're talking about here? The Oceana building's been there for 100 years, roughly. It was redone in the 1920s. In the 1920s, there was also this building, Village Hall. There was the fire department. There's the 81 Main. And then there's the post office. All these are neoclassical buildings. Are we going to now? I know. I'm worried about the massing. And what I'm understanding, I'm talking as fast as Patty, is that if you disallow any code changes, all of a sudden there are 18 spaces that are now going to be on the street because the front building doesn't have any parking. And so it's this kind of game of chicken, which also happened at 100 Main. You know, if we take all this parking off site, we can meet your requirements. But then all of a sudden, where are you going to put those cars?
Thank you.
I'm asking for no zone changes, however.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Mike Merrill, 32 Walnut. I just have a couple of new points, actually. One, regarding the zoning, obviously that's the big question here, whether the back of the building is part of the residential street that is Palisades currently, or if it is part of the downtown district. Personally, I think if it spills over onto Palisades Street, then Palisades Street is a different district. You know, the question that comes up, though, is this was zoned as MDR2 many years ago, and it's been that way, and suddenly, as of right, it's not supposed to be MDR2s, but it's never been challenged that I know of before until we have something else that we want to do here. You know, my question would be, why wasn't it challenged before if we really wanted this to be downtown previously? Second, probably even larger question, because this doesn't come up almost never in any one of these applications. You know, we're talking about the benefit to the village and village services, but more critical to everybody in the village is, what is the net benefit to the Dobbs Ferry School District? If we've got 24 new families in this structure, they're all going to have to go to school here. We don't have the facilities for them currently. We already have overcrowding in the schools. So we're going to, what, stuff more people and more cars into places that don't exist? You know, ultimately, the tax base also has to support the schools. That means the infrastructure, that means the teachers. You know, and if there isn't a net benefit from those people moving in, it's actually going to be a drain on the rest of the village because they're going to have to cover the costs of those school children. And that's going to bring everybody's property values down. So it's not just the incremental from this one property. Those services, those are probably the most costly services that are being required from these 24 new units being proposed. They haven't been discussed whatsoever. I'd like to hear, you know, what the economics of that are from the space and the units, what's going to be generated from the rental or you know, sale revenues, what the tax base is going to be, and how that's going to pay for all of those school services. Who's going to build the new school?
One of the things that is generally given and required is an estimate of the number of children out of all the developments that we do and neighboring communities do. And I'm sure that either has or will be provided to us.
Well, and it's similar to the argument of whether this is going to be a dormitory or whether this is going to be a place where, you know, families are going to back kids in to take advantage of the schools. Right, so, you know, the same question that you ask about Mercy College students being jammed into new residential units also applies to new families, because that does happen in the village.
Well,
thank you.
We tend to like new people coming into the village, actually. But.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes to you.
Peggy Blizzard, 12 Chestnut Street. Michael, you.
Yes.
You saved a picture that I showed. Can you put that back up for us? It's called a view. You have it. I saw it when you were flashing through before. I'm begging you not to change the zoning down there. And we gave you people, I hope Liz gave it to you, a petition that all the people down on that street signed, if people either own the houses or who live down there, asking me not to change. Did you get that?
I don't believe I have seen that.
Well, there's a petition. Ronnie Curian went around and got it signed. So you've got about 48 or 50 signatures. And some other people have said tonight they'd like to sign it. They didn't get a chance to before. This is a very gifted group of people. And they can come up with something beautiful for you that will not go over 40 feet. Now, this is what I showed on Monday. Of course, the light's on it. It's a fairy tale village we live in. And this one of the things that's economical about this place is it's become a movie set. We had a movie, or a TV filmed a couple of weeks ago, and right now they're filming another movie in town. If you start changing this and you destroy all of this, that we're going to lose that industry. And when they make a movie in town, everybody gets a payday. Now, if you look right here, this was taken from the aqueduct, or actually on our porch, but it's from the aqueduct. If you let them build here, we will lose all of that. Well, actually, we're going to go to here. We will lose all of that. If they do the 40 feet high, we'll just lose a little bit, and it won't be so bad. So I'm encouraging you, please do not change the zoning and do not give a variance. Let them work within what they have already. The whole reason we have a zoning code is to protect homeowners. I mean, you all live here, you have homes, you want that home protected. And part of what protects it is the zoning code. So please don't change it.
Thank you, Peggy. Neighbors?
I'm Mavis Kane on South Lawn Avenue. And many years ago, we were talking about the economics of the village. We bought a house on South Lawn for, if any of you know my house, it's rather beautiful. It's up on a hill, the bright red door and bright red cherries. We bought it for $28,000. And you know why we bought it for such a low price? We were told that the schools were on double session, and we had an infant daughter. And we were told, you must register at Masters because you don't want her going to school in the late session because the schools are so overcrowded that she will be going to school when it's getting dark and coming home and it's really dark. So we did just that. And but I just want to remind you, the price of this house is probably $1 million now. You want to drive up South Lawn Avenue and take a look at it. We literally paid $28,500 because the schools were so crowded. And that's just something, you know, someone else brought up, that the number of people moving into this building with kids, because every article you read in the newspaper about moving to the River Towns, it's because you move to the River Towns when you want to start a family. There's a poster down at the train station, and it says just that. People, when they want to raise a family, they come to Dogs or Hastings. So you will fill up the schools again, and maybe it'll be good for another young couple the way we were, and they'll buy a house for a song but I don't think that's what you want. And the other thing, I guess this is really Architecture Review Board, I would deplore the loss of that beautiful facade of the Oceanic Press.
And tell the architect.
I know it's their area,
thank
but
you.
The other area of the economics and the schools is, I think, pertinent.
Thank you. Others, thank you. Go ahead and see if the board has any other questions.
Yeah, just really quickly, because I don't want people watching this on television to be fearful of what's happening in the school. I'm on the facilities committee at the school. Some of you may be aware of the fact that we built a number of additions several years ago. We actually right now are operating well under what our capacity is. I'm not going to get into the economics, that's David's thing. But there is no risk at the moment of us providing, if we had 50 kids or something, we're not going to need to build any additional facilities in the school.
Thank you.
Just because I'm the attorney, I can't help myself. That number of kids that Patty just threw out as an example is not based on the data David Smith is going to analyze his area of expertise.
Right.
I don't want anyone misunderstanding the number that Patty threw out by way of example. Patty.
I'm going to try to find the view from the aqueduct because this is a very, Peggy's view is a wonderful view, it really is. But it's not a public view, it's not the view from the aqueduct. The only thing I want to say, maybe then we can move on because you've got other stuff on the agenda. We had the Festa about a month and a half ago, I don't remember. But I'm walking down the street, and a woman comes up to me and she starts lambasting me for destroying the village. She said, "You're doing terrible, terrible things to the village." I said, "What am I doing that's terrible?" She goes, "You're moving too many people into the village. I just heard the other day you moved two Brazilian people in onto the lower Main Street." I go, "Yeah." And she got flustered and she just walked away, but then before she got too far, she turned around and she said, "How many is a Brazilian anyway?" So I think we need to be careful with our facts. People throw things out, they're not accurate. We need to have the accurate information, and we need to deal with it. We need to solve problems that really exist. Bruce, I think that's a real, I'm not sure what it is. I agree with you that era had a genealogy that spawned other stuff, which in a very positive way. I have complete confidence in our pod to be working on the different things, and of course, when we get to the ARP, the issue, though, that's important is that either one of those facades could work regardless.
We'll do it on ARP because, they could work, but you're taking off something that is historic.
No, I'm saying either one could work without changing the reason we're in front of the planning board.
Mrs. Sanzo?
I've said a lot of, my name is Suzanne Sanzo. I'm resident of Palisades Peak for 40 years. And the proposers here have brought a lot of legal and financial pressure, but they're still proposing to build something that's taller than the existing zoning for Palisades allows. And the residents of Palisades would be adversely impacted by the proposed big financial bonanza. And I'm very happy about that. Thank you.
Thank you.
I've been hearing about the economic boom to come to Dawes Ferry, but every study that we've come in contact with has said the same thing. Increasing population does not lower your taxes, does not lower your expenses. It increases the expenses. Every study has come to the same conclusion. How do you explain that, Mr. Steinschneider?
I would ask Rob to.
Another thing, we've heard about no impact on services. I was talking with an ex-fire chief. He said, we are in a state where we can no longer have a volunteer fire department. If the population continues to increase, they're going to have a professional fire department. Are you prepared to lay out the money to maintain and equip a professional fire department? Also, school taxes, will increase, and we know not everybody pays their school taxes on time.
Thank you. It would be helpful if we could set a date for a work session, as was discussed.
Yeah. The week of the 16th.
The week of the 16th?
I can do any, I can't do Thursday nights. Yeah. You know, but I could do any of the other night, any of the other days, 16, 17, 18.
Me too.
18 or 19 of November?
Can't do the 19th.
I can't do 19 because it's Thursday night.
You can't do the 19th. 18th?
17th.
18 is no good for me.
17th?
17 is fine.
Okay.
So maybe it would be worse.
When is it, your birthday? Yes.
My son's birthday.
Well.
Yeah, it's going to start getting started, but I can't do 17. But if that's the best date for everyone else, then I guess.
17th? You can't do.
I have another meeting, but I can try to work.
And Monday the 16th.
Around it.
16? No, I can't. I can't
do. Would you like a 6:30 on the 17th?
No, that doesn't work for me.
Yeah,
that doesn't work for me.
No, okay.
So when you 16th?
I can't make 16.
No, 16. I think we're back to 18.
Thanksgiving.
I think it's
18 seems to be on the board.
Make it 16th. I'll cancel the thing if that's the only date.
16?
8?
That's not ARB night, is it? Second? No.
No, it isn't. No, that's the 9th.
16th.
Yeah, that's the 9th.
Monday.
What, the 16th?
16th is a Monday.
Is that okay for you, Dwayne?
16? Yes, 16th is good for me. What time?
What is it?
Who can't take this back?
I think we're.
I have to move something.
Yeah.
But.
Board good?
16th.
What time you want to do, Chairman?
7?
And your regular December meeting is the 2nd, just for planning purposes?
Yeah, except.
Somebody in the conference, right?
No, our regular meeting is the 3rd. But okay. I think I will be making a recommendation to move it to the 2nd if that's still.
If you're willing.
Yeah, if the board is willing. Okay, so we've set a work session for Monday, November 16 at 7 o'clock in this room.
Great. Before we adjourn for this evening, is there anything else that we can provide to you before the 16th to make that work session even more productive?
The SketchUp file.
The actual thumb drives?
Okay. The file. I don't know how the big files are. If you posted FTP
it
or something.
We put them on jump drives.
Okay.
That'll be the easiest way.
This way you just plug it right in.
And you can download SketchUp for free.
Yeah, yeah. No, I haven't, so. Thank you.
Okay.
We'll be interested to see what you come up with.
All right. So I like to move that we continue the public hearing to the next meeting.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Do a second.
Yeah,
second.
All in favor?
Where do you go to the second?
That's just to carry the public hearing.
To carry the
public hearing.
Just a little question. Correspond with the board. What's the best way to do that?
Drop a letter off at Village Hall or email Liz and she'll get it to the board.
Maybe to the board.
Yeah. You said it to Liz Draper.
Right, no.
Or Betsy.
To address it individually, each of
the members. Do it to the members of the planning board. Then she'll forward it.
We regularly get forwarded from her whatever people send.
Yeah. Email works very well that way. All right, the next item on the agenda, item number 4, is a continuation of a public hearing for review and recommendation of the Board of Trustees for potential zoning code amendments and the what we call the flow chart, which is the how an application gets from beginning to end. Dwight, maybe you could take a lead here and...
How much you bars?
Flowchart's easy. It's been done mostly by Alan with input from different folks here along the way. And the resolution's been prepared to recommend to the building department, leaving in place their discretion to apply that for applications that are presented for the Architectural and Historic Review Board and the Planning Board. I thought that made sense. It's not a matter that would fit into the zoning ordinance or any of the local laws or laws of the village, as far as I could see. It's more of a procedural recommendation, so I don't know if we're all set with it, and I think it's been hammered out pretty well, then it just needs a motion to move it and second it to do it.
You're talking about just the are we acting just on the flow chart?
Just on the flow chart.
Flow chart.
And where are we sending this to the building department?
Yes.
All right.
Mr. Chairman, maybe you want to do one thing. Take a motion to open the public hearing first. So if there's any comments on the, I know there's been comments on the flow chart and a lot of discussion, but I think you wanted the public hearing on all of it?
Yeah, I guess we would need that. It's not administrative. I move that we open the public hearing on the, the chart is called the building permit approval process. And it, what it does, it just, it shows, I'm sorry we don't have one up on the screen, but the applicant starts here and here goes through a series of steps depending on what the nature of the application is and which boards it would be going to and so on.
Why don't you open the public, open the public hearing on everything? And then deal with
can you guys pass that down to Donna?
Yeah, zoning code too.
And the zoning code, yeah.
It's for Donna.
All right, so I amend my motion to open the public hearing on the building permit approval process chart and on the resolution of the Planning Board recommendation to Board of Trustees regarding certain proposed zoning ordinance amendments.
Excuse me, I don't know which flow chart you're using. Is the CAB on here?
Yes. Do I have a second on the motion on the public hearing?
Second.
All in favor? All right, thank you. Are we going to take these as one, one, or should we do them separately, Dwight?
Yeah, I thought that the resolutions get directed into different ways. The other resolution would go to the Board of Trustees. This one,
that's true.
This one goes to the Building Department.
So
can we look at this only because I'm also liaison to the CAB?
Right.
Where is it on this chart?
It's not on this chart.
Should it be?
Well, maybe we need to talk about it more.
By code, do applications go through the CAB? Does anything go to the CAB?
The CAB usually gets when you get your first plans. The CAB also gets their plans.
Okay.
Well, with the CAB, it's a recommending board.
It's a recommending board.
They just give their comments on. So, look at the codes and the system.
So they would be a box outside of this flow with
an
arrow.
Board.
With an with an arrow into.
Yeah, because it's interesting. I mean,
yeah, think of it in a box.
I don't know to whom would they make comments to us because
I would assume it would be to you because
it's never
architectural.
Happened.
Yeah.
If it might just go to the building department. So if we put a separate arrow
with the box.
Building department review right up on top, they recommend, and it's an arrow back and forth to the CAB and then back to the building department.
You need to bring your sketch up and work on it.
That was a question
I could have brought my laptop.
You know, the swallowed in half as to when we have recommendations, who does it go to? So
seems
it
like this
the
should
building
be.
Department?
Yeah, because I don't think we've ever seen a. A memo or recommendation from the CAB.
I mean, it might be interesting for us if it was relevant. The building department, I would guess, would make the determination whether something that was referred to them and then their comments, if it would be helpful in our determination, I would think they would send it on to us.
This is what they do. They advise the village board of trustees and other boards on matters affecting the preservation, development, and use of natural and man-made features conditions of the village so as to enhance the long-range value of the environment for the people of the village.
Yeah.
Amongst other things. They do studies and surveys. They're just sort of trying to maintain, natural features in the village.
I've been on that board, and it's a very useful board, but I've not seen them as part of the building application, process.
So who's gonna
I think the building department should forward each application to them and see if they have any comments.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And then I think Rob, your idea was good to have a box from the building department to the CAB for referral and comment and recommendation.
So
Yeah, because they do receive the plans from the...
Yeah, and usually have meetings and meet and make, and they have, sometimes there's no comments.
Right.
And they can do that, sort of, so I think that's a good addition to add to that.
Yeah, good.
It's a, I would think, Alan, since you've been creating these things, it would be a two-way arrow. They, building department sends it to them, CAB sends back to the building department. Now the building department has it to follow through with its regular process. Does that make sense?
Sure.
Yeah.
Two minutes. Actually, can I get that, your copy, since I can run away? I'll just mark them, I'm gonna write it up. So the other, question, after ZBA, if code variance is required, does it ever go directly onto, is, could it be potentially complete, or would it go back up to building department review?
It would always have to go back to building department. If you have a variance, let's say you wanna build a deck, may not need site plan approval, but you may need a variance because it encroaches on a setback. They have to go to the building department for a permit.
Right, but once, it could go after ZBA, it could be done, is that right?
Yeah, could be, absolutely.
So at this point, basically, it could, it would either...
I think that's why it says the arrow goes...
Yeah.
ZBA required, back to the building department, and then it goes to the BOT in some zones if necessary. If not, you know, it'll skip that and go right to the final flow chart to the issuing permit.
There are actually quite a number of exceptions to this flow chart. And you, before you know it, you got something that's more complicated than the one that Patty showed us that was, you know, five times more complicated than this. So I felt like a 98% solution was more useful than covering every single possible scenario.
It's pretty good.
Yeah.
Darius, then what happens to this?
This will be on file in the building department. I mean, this is what happens now anyway.
Should we get like an illustrated one, put it up in the...
I think this could be there.
Little pictures and so people can...
Brian can point to it instead of having it.
Yeah. So they can understand how this, what's supposed to happen.
I think it should be a game.
Yeah.
Somehow you can't win. It's sort of set up in such a way where everybody loses.
Everybody's denied.
Do we want to go ahead with a resolution based on this change, or would
yes.
you like, okay.
No, I don't want to see it again.
Okay.
So, I would move we approve this version to be sent to the building department. Is there a second? All in favor? Oh, good.
Wow. That was
and thank you, Mr. Hale, for all of your... Yeah.
You're welcome.
All of
did you
your
vote
work.
Yes or no? I did.
Okay.
You warned us here.
The second part, and I won't say the more important part, but the second part is a resolution recommending to the Board of Trustees certain proposed zoning ordinance amendments, which have been discussed at length at this board over the past several months, I'm sorry to say. And Dwight, again, we have a cover resolution with a long piece of the changes there, which I would prefer not to read, but unless council makes me read them.
No, I think these have been discussed, you know, I would even go as far as almost a year being discussed by your board. They have been available for people to look at. We did notice it in the enterprise as a public hearing. I think people have commented on it. I think you're ready to move it along as a recommendation to the Board of Trustees. Once the Board of Trustees gets it, we will be very detailed in our proposal in the enterprise so people can look at it. It'll probably be a page or so long, if not longer. And then they'll be recommend, you know, they'll consider it.
And they'll have a public hearing.
They will public hearing. They may agree with you. They may disagree with you. They may, you know, do something in between.
Right.
But there are some important changes. I think people were realizing that a few months ago that came to the meeting and said, you know, we need these changes.
Yeah.
There are a lot of necessary changes and it'll help the process along.
Good.
I think.
So with that, let me read the resolution, and it is a public hearing, so I will take comment if anyone wishes to comment. Whereas by prior action, the Board of Trustees established under the chairmanship of Trustee Koenigsberg an ad hoc committee to review and recommend changes to the substance and procedures of the Dobbs Ferry Village Code related to the AHRB and related issues. And whereas the work of said ad hoc committee culminated in an August 15, 2014 memorandum from Trustee Koenigsberg recommending certain ordinance and processing revisions, and whereas the Board of Trustees referred the subject August 15, 2014 memorandum. Annex here two is a memoranda to the Planning Board for review and recommendation. Whereas in addition to the recommendations contained in the August 15 memo, the village's consulting engineer pursuant to discussion with the village's public works foreman has proposed a number of technical ordinance revisions related to paving and stormwater management. Whereas the building inspector's office also suggested a number of ordinance modifications, and whereas a number of special work sessions, regular public hearings, and scheduled public hearings, including the public hearing of November 4, 2015, have been held to review and discuss all of the subject ordinance modifications, and whereas during this lengthy review process, a consensus has been reached regarding a number of ordinance revisions related to review authority and minor modifications, clarifications regarding calculation of height in the downtown zoning districts, and these are attached as Exhibit A, proposed ordinance amendments, and now they're therefore, be it resolved that the Village of Dobbs Ferry Planning Board recommends that the Board of Trustees consider adoption of the ordinance modifications as enumerated in Exhibit A. All said amendments subject to legal review to ensure consistency with other ordinance provisions, and be it resolved that this resolution shall have an effective date of November 4, 2015. It is a public hearing. I would take comment if anybody would dare. Yes, Mr. Merrill.
Mike Merrill, 32 Baldwin Street. I just have a few comments because obviously this has been a document in flux for quite a while, and I think it's been pared down pretty well. There were some definitions added more recently, including the first story, which was actually something that I was going to ask about until it was put in this week, talking about the basement or cellar level. I don't know if the intent was to continue to define that as something that it's also primarily below grade, or if it was to allow for anything that was above grade and counted as another basement or another two basements or whatever it might add up to be. But you know, that was in line with a number of the other things that were discussed as far as building heights and considerations of grade. So whether you wanted to clarify that any, I had another couple comments on. You know, the process, you know, not to open up the flowchart, but because of the way that the process works and sometimes goes back around in circles, the one thing that was on the chart about the ZBA and code variances, it just kind of struck me as, does that take it away from the other boards, or does a code variance also have to be considered? You know, the application comes for the planning board or the AHRB. And two other points, you know, talking about best practices, you know, the Board of Trustees is currently the final approver in five zones. You know, typically they're not involved in the approval process for specific reasons, and I think we've discussed again in circles before whether it should be recommended that they should only have the ability to affirm or decline decisions that were provided by the previous boards, as opposed to having the capacity to override, which effectively gives them you know, the ability to channel something all the way from the start of the process through the end of the process without you know, any real breaks from the other boards that are the professional boards. Irvington does not you know, have the boards as final approver. You know, to again bring up Irvington in best practices, Irvington also has a 30-foot buffer requirement along the aqueduct for any building request. You know, I don't think that's realistic in downtown Dobbs Ferry, but, you know, there's got to be something in between, between 0 and 30 that is at least appropriate as a starting point before it requires a variance. It's not unrealistic, and certainly everything else that people envision going down the trail, you know, they're not expecting to, you know, be walled in, right, regardless of where it is. So I think that's something that you could use Irvington as an example and say this is a starting point for fixing another thing that's in the code. Thanks.
We agree. Thank you very much.
To that point, there was discussion about an overlay, and how did we leave the aqueduct 10-foot?
We were going to use the downtown design guidelines and hopefully work on that.
We got a couple of things that we haven't done yet. That's one. And I did look, and there's a possible grant we could get from the Greenway.
Good.
So I'll follow up with that and get you information on that. The second is we haven't done the East Elm Street area either. The goal was, let's see if we could ever get this done and then bring those other things along. And we definitely feel they need to be done on the Old Croton Aqueduct and East Elm Street. Mr. Chairman, would it help if I just listed out what these items are and a quick thing on the rationale? Because
sure.
I think there's a couple of them that we may want to discuss ourselves.
Yeah, please.
Also, just to answer Mr. Marrow, Rob has created a framework for evaluating the conditions along the aqueduct. And so now the job is to fill it in, and Dwight is looking for a grant to get the study underway.
Rob has fleshed out what elements would be in the study or what the end product would be.
So there's motion, but it's sort of slow.
And the two projects that were approved had a 10-foot buffer for BART, 66, 68, and 78.
Right. Yes, but only
because we fought for it. Well, he asked, though, is there something in the middle between 0 and 30? And the planning board listened to you and did this.
Yeah.
Now, I think you have the resolution pending. Someone should make a motion and second it and then discuss it.
Yeah. I made the motion.
Yeah, put it in a second.
We need a second.
Well, what Dwight was going to just illuminate it a little bit, right?
Why don't you make the motion
after or before, whichever way you prefer.
Make the motion and have discussion.
So he read the motion. I think the
motion.
Right,
you need a second.
All right.
A second.
Okay.
Okay, I wanted to just recap quickly, and then I know there's a couple of spots that we need to make sure we're set on. The elimination of the TAC has all been settled. We understood that one of the reasons to do the flow chart, and it sprang from that was, okay, now the TAC's going, the building department's doing all this stuff.
Right.
What's their process? And there was a lot of input from the public on that. Modifications to the SEP, we had talked about taking some of that responsibility back to the planning board. We're leaving it with the Architectural and Historic Review Board. We corrected a 45-degree angle thing. I'm skipping to page 2 quickly. Building massing, we just noted there's no change in the ordinance that the planning board will also look at massing.
Right.
There's quite a bit of work on the AHRB timing for review of applications, but we've been through it and no changes from what was discussed many months ago. AHRB advisory to the Board of Trustees. Highlighted, I hope you had colored versions there. We made one change in the original, the latest version, and then there's a further version that Steve Brosnahan put forward as a suggestion. So we're going to have to pick one of these two. So let's hold off for a second, go back and come back to that and discuss that one, because I think that's the most controversial piece of this. AHRB exemptions, the building department reminded me that we're supposed to also include the fences. Sorry, this page isn't numbered, but is that, we're still following this okay? And so the fences have been added to that. The building department exemption review procedures, they haven't changed. Now going to building height in the downtown zones. We went back and forth on this. It's pretty much the language is staying exactly as our last description. Then again, from Steve Brosnahan, we had discussed this problem, and there's a change in the definition of first story. I think this fits to our overall strategy of saying, how can it be you can have two levels of parking and then start counting the stories? And what Steve did was say, well, that first level of those two must qualify as a basement, which isn't a story anyway. So you'd only have one level of parking, but it could be on top of a parking level that was in a basement that qualified as basement space. So that language has been included. And the revised language reads, the lowest story of, or the ground story of any building excluding a basement or a cellar that is not counted as a story, up to two levels of structured parking located below another use, one level of which is basement, no more than 6 feet above ground, for 50% of the total perimeter. I think that's all what we wanted to do. Is anybody? So let's look at the, is there anything else beside that? Let's look at the AHRB as advised.
I just have one question.
Okay.
Because I agree with the notion of the sky exposure plane would be the AHRB. But I assume, and especially based on the flow chart, that we would be aware, presumably they're submitting that, whether they conform or don't conform and so on, to the building department when they make their submission. So we would be aware of any violation of the sky exposure plane, presumably as they presented to us, right? Because since we're in this mode where we're trying, where we agree that massing is a little, like, each of us, it wouldn't make sense for us to be doing it if we weren't aware, at least, that there was a sky exposure plane issue, even if authority ultimately rests on them.
I mean, I assume each board would see the same set of plans, so if they put sky exposure plane on the plans, then...
Then presumably we would see it.
That's correct, right, Brian? I mean, they don't get a separate set of plans with just the sky exposure plane on them, do they?
No, it's part of the regular plan.
Right.
So, okay. So we would see it.
Yeah. But we wouldn't have their notice that it violates it unless we ask the building department to provide us with it. Why would they?
Well, you can see it when it's sticking out of the line.
You'll see it, I guess.
Or that they're not going to grant a waiver.
Oh, gotcha. Right. Yeah.
I don't want to make a big deal.
Like Alan says, you know, if you tried to put that one back in, we'd have about 14 more arrows going
down.
I think the point is, as we look at it from a massing point of view,
we'll see it. We'll get the information.
We would know.
We would know it.
That we will.
There's nothing keeping us from asking for it, right?
Yeah, right. No, it would be on the plans, I think so. Okay, so you're back to the...
So we've looked at... for quite a while, and this I think there we need to make sure that we have a majority and consensus of making one of these two changes, and which one, so that we could then act on the entire thing. If we don't have a majority in favor of either, then I think it can be struck and the rest of it approved and moved on. But I think we're going to have a majority, but I just want to make sure we're clear that here's the alternate language that Steve's come up with. The Board of Trustees shall be responsible, this is all in yellow on there, for final review and approval of all applications, including, for example, design review, excessive similarity, dissimilarity, on review and recommendation by the Architectural and Historic Review Board for the following districts, they're the same districts. And then Steve had the thought that in our recommendation we would change the projects in a zone which exceeds a total of 1 acre would now be 2 acres. The Board of Trustees may defer said decision-making powers to AHRB. This is as per said. Where the BOT retains authority, the AHRB shall recommend approval with modifications or disapproval, and the matter shall be then heard and determined by the Board of Trustees. In the event that the AHRB makes a recommendation different from that of the Planning Board, the position of each board shall be made in writing to the Board of Trustees, and the AHRB shall be the decision-making authority in all other zoning districts on issues within the AHRB's purview. So that's a little tweaking of the language that's above.
Does this track the language used in describing the role of the Planning Board?
Yes.
Yes.
That's what I was going to ask. So there's a paragraph similar to this for the Planning Board.
Yeah, that's, I assume, because...
I liked the suggestion, but we're not ready to move it. We could also take Steve's suggestion, which is a good one, that the Board of Trustees could also consider deferring site plan review and approval to the planning board at its sole discretion. Same thing that the AHRB would. Why don't we?
I didn't suggest that, but it's a good idea.
I mean, there's one other higher level, which I know is politically not there yet, but I'll just mention it, which is that the scenario that someone suggested where the default would be that it ends here or with the reconciliation here, and the Board of Trustees, by an affirmative
supermajority
could elect to see it. In other words, rather than the default being that they get it and they can decide they don't want to see it, the default would be that they don't get it, but they can vote to take it if for some reason they feel strongly about it. Which, again, I don't know if that would be politically acceptable. I'm into the idea that we shouldn't hold up all the other important things that are in here for that. But I just want to cite that as another.
As I said, that I think is a significant change. We'd have to strike this section from the action of the resolution and redraft, and we can certainly do that.
And the planning board section.
I think you almost have enough here. We left in the resolution that the lawyers get stuck actually making sure the language fits in. So we're just saying we wanted to add that the VOT. I could probably turn that into what the basic, it says the Board of Trustees may defer said decision-making powers of the AHRB at its sole discretion. We changed the words to the planning board at its sole discretion and then fit it in the right spot, and we have effectively done that. And I think there's enough in here that's been on the website and stuff that we can say that's been adequately sent out to the public. I think that's a good idea. I mean, if we would like to do that, I can take care of that. I would have to find the section where it goes. It'd be just a note, probably say, similarly,
so
keep it under five.
We're looking at this now. I mean, we're looking at that one line.
And
putting it into the.
Or maybe just asterisk it and say, the Board of Trustees may defer its decision. Add in also. So, there'll be a way to do it if that's the intent.
But put it down into this section somewhere?
Dwight, what do you expect is going to happen with this recommendation? It's going to go to the Board of Trustees, and they would have their own discussions about whatever we send them.
In any case, in public hearing.
So part of me thinks we should make it what we, you know, maybe what Rob suggested, and of course there'll be discussion. And
so pull this item?
Yeah, it just says the Board of Trustees may defer at their discretion, so it's not making it part of the normal. It's they have to act to do it.
You're talking about the AHRB or planning board?
Well, it would be both.
For the planning board, it has it. Planning board has everything. Board of Trustees has everything in the five districts. So if it's greater than 1 acre, it can decide to defer to you guys, but it has to affirmatively say that it doesn't want it.
But what Rob is talking about
this
is
just
very different
to the.
You could turn it on its head and say.
You want to say.
They only get it if they ask for it, as opposed to. Yeah. Now, I don't know politically, you know.
I just think things fall through the cracks that way. If they know about it and say, okay, it's 1 acre, you know, it's not that many 1 acre properties.
2 acres.
Yeah. Well, now it's one in the code. You're recommending two for the AHRB, I think.
They can leave, you know, they'll get it.
And not many 2 acre properties.
And
they could say, that's usually the thought process was it was a big property. They're going to want to have some control over it. But if they say, okay, it's not a big issue, then push it off. The planning board can do it. That was the thought. This was discussed at length. I remember this paragraph was rewritten a lot of times in 2010.
It is
a lot.
Substantive change, Rob. I don't know.
No, it is. It's doing a 180.
It probably should maybe even start with something different, like that's the memorandum for discussion with the Board of Trustees. One of the ways to, there's been a lot of comment from the public on this, one of the ways to address that comment would be, would they consider this and then leave it out of this at this point? Because I think that should be a discussion. I think.
Yeah.
You're taking power from somebody. You, don't just send it to them cold.
Oh, really? That's been your experience?
Yeah, can we vote ourselves a raise?
That's funny. I haven't had that problem.
There's some good ideas springing up there. But so we'll take the, if it's okay, and we'll find out what, when the vote comes back. We're going to take the alternate language, and we're going to add a footnote to it that this should be also changed in the planning board. They could defer to the planning board and not pursue it. And with that change, that's pretty much, and I have to call this a new update as of 11:04:15. I will, or where do we stand? We need a vote or a discussion?
The motion's been made.
Yeah.
It's been seconded. So all in favor?
So, sorry, the motion includes doing what with this exactly?
With that section?
Subject to those changes?
We had one minor change. It's the version that
the second one.
Steve Brosnahan put forward, which is all in yellow, with the change that we are going to asterisk and note that the planning board, Board of Trustees, may just defer said decision-making powers to the planning board at its sole discretion also. We'll put that in. That's the only change from what you got, other than where this first section is replaced by the one.
Okay, so the vote right now is the yellow plus add planning board.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. So, all in favor? Opposed?
Okay. Alan, I want to give your thought. I know this is, we've discussed this. Just what your issue is?
Yeah, my issues are, you know, they've come up again and again, but 3/4 of New York State governments do not give elected bodies control over individual development decisions. The norm is the Board of Trustees makes the code, and the planning board applies the code to individual projects. Well, I believe that the Board of Trustees has a valid interest in approving these decisions. I believe that this section weakens the existing checks and balances and moves us away from governmental best practices.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, those of you that have been with us since the beginning. We move to item 5, public hearing on site plan review for proposed multifamily residential building at 255 Broadway.
Oh, it's Christina.
She didn't have a side yard problem.
I'm Christine Griffin. I'm the architect representing 552 Corporation, who is the owner of this property. And we are planning to remove a dilapidated house that is in disrepair, and we're going to put a three-story, 10-unit, multi-family building on the property. This is just our first go-around at the an image of the building that we'd like to see on this property. It's approximately the same width of the house that's there now. And I'm going to show you some contextual photos in a few minutes. This is our site plan, and what we're planning to do is to align the front of the building with where the existing building is now. And this is showing a driveway that is in the same location as the one is now, just widening it to 16 feet. And then we're going to have a driveway slope down to a garage underneath the building and then to a lower parking area in the back. Because we want to conceal the cars as much as we can. We're going to have an evergreen screen in the back so that this open parking area will be screened from the aqueduct. The building will meet the setback on the side, a 10-foot setback on this side, and we're required to have 20 feet altogether, but we're going to have a setback of 17.9 on this side so that we can have space for the driveway. Our parking layout is showing that we were going to have 7 spots inside the garage, 4 outside, for a total of 11, and then we have 2 spots on the street. That gives us 13. 13 is the number that we need for the 10 units that we're proposing. On this level, we're going to have, on the level of the garage, we're going to have an access to an elevator going up to through the building, and we're going to have a small studio apartment on this level.
Christina?
Yes.
It might be helpful if you move to the other side so the board can see it.
This is the section through the site, and this is showing that our maximum building height is 57.5 feet. And the way we determine this is to take an average of the buildings on properties 200 feet to each side. We did not count there is a small gas station. We did not count that because there is an exception in the code. It is an anomaly. We don't need to count, include that. So we have an average of 57.5, and that's because there's a building on the to the north that is 5 stories high, and the building to the south that's 3 stories. So our building fits inside this maximum height, and in fact, the building, the front facade is about 36 feet above grade, and in the back it's 40 feet something. Can't quite read that, but. And then we have a stair and elevator enclosure that comes up to roof decks. We've located that stair and elevator also on the northern side, so it's more towards the taller building. The buildings seem to be getting higher as you go up Broadway. And this is showing the slopes going down. We have a very gently sloping site, so we start up here at a driveway slope of 5% for 20 feet. We get on 12%. And then we have an opening into the garage here at 5%, down again, and then we have a parking area in the back that's open, and we end up with a retaining wall in the back that's just 4 feet high. That's to the parking level, and then we'll have, of course, a railing on top of that. And then the setback in the back is required to be, I think, 25 feet, and we have a little more than that, except that we have a tiny piece coming outside of it, this coming in it. And that's going to give us the space that we need for our evergreen screen that we want to put in front of the parking area. This is the engineer's plans. I know we did not submit this, but this is from Hudson Engineering, just showing the preliminary plan for drainage, and the idea is that we're going to put drainage underneath the, in the garage, and we're going to have a drainage system that leads to cul-de-sacs that will be underneath the open parking area in the back. This is just a site plan to show existing and new. What you see in purple is the existing structure and the impervious paved areas. The existing driveway, paths, the building, this little greenhouse deck, and there's a pool. And if you add up all those impervious surfaces, the existing is 46%, and we're going to be at 56.4% with our new building, and the maximum is 60%. These are just our photographs of the neighborhood. This is a view looking up the aqueduct. This property with the overgrown trees is 255 Broadway. This is looking directly at the property from the aqueduct. This is a three-story building on one side, five-story on the other. This is the street view showing the gas station. Two properties down. This is a property next door. This is an eight-unit building. It's three stories high. This is the current house we're planning to remove. It's three stories high. And this is the very large building that has 59 units in it. This is the building we're removing. And these are just other, these are views of the house showing the side. There's an old overgrown pool that we're going to take out. And just another view of the overgrown property. This is just a neighborhood plan just to show some general, this is a tax map that's been blown up, and it's just demonstrating the different massing that you see of the buildings. This is the building we're proposing as 10 units. The one south of it has 8, and the one just north has 59 units. So there's quite a variety of sizes and shapes on Broadway. Our plans are showing, these are our schematic floor plans showing on the garage level, we're going to have a lobby with the elevator studio apartment. On the upper levels, we're planning to have 3 units, 1 2-bedroom, 2 1-bedroom. They're located so we can have the view of the river with decks, and there'll be one in front also with a deck. We would like to have, make sure that every unit has outdoor space and a parking space. Second and third is very similar to the lower units. This is our stair that goes all the way up, so an elevator, so that there are roof decks for the top 3 units, and we located those tall elements northern side towards the five-story building. These are our elevations, just showing the front facade. The very top of the building, just see if this was supposed to be here, but this is showing 52 feet 7 to this point, but the maximum height is allowed is 56.5. This is the front elevation, this is the entrance. What we wanted to do is keep the lower studio unit on this side away from the driveway. The entrance is next to the driveway for easy access. We tried to break up the building so that we really break up the mass of it. Although in the front it's not very big, it's more the, it's much longer on the sides. This is a rear elevation. This is the gray at the building, and this is the way we're treating the garage so that it looks like it's a foundation rather than a garage. And then there's going to be a lower parking area that we're going to screen with trees. Side elevation, we've done a lot to try to break up this building. This is actually the existing house is 3 stories and has a underground parking area, very similar to this idea, curb cut in a similar location. Our building's coming back and 35 feet from the old house. And this is just showing different ideas that we have for breaking up the massing, creating these little angled bay windows so they can, you know, help capture views for these units. This is showing railings and roof deck. This is our stair bulkhead. And this is our south elevation, just showing again ideas of massing so we can break up the bulk of the length of the building, similar to the other facade. Now, these are some of our view studies showing before and after. This is the house that we're planning to take down. This is before and this is after. So the building we're proposing is similar in height to the building next door, three-story, but you know, much smaller than the five-story. And it's actually almost exactly the same width as the house. These are existing trees. We superimposed the 3D view on a photograph. And there's already very tall trees along this property and some on this side. This is another before and after street view of this existing house. This building is going to be aligned with the prevailing setback, which is really where I think these houses are almost in the same alignment, but this is actually going in the same place. This facade without the decks is lined up with where the existing facade is. Another before and after, although it's a little bit hard to see, we inserted the building here. This is the gas station at the end. And then in the back, you can just about see the second floor of the existing house right here. And this is after. Our building's getting taller, it's getting deeper.
Where are you shooting that?
This is from the aqueduct.
That's from the aqueduct.
The aqueduct. And we may come back to you with another view showing this trim down. I mean, part of it, I think, is on the aqueduct, but part of this overgrowth is on the property.
You'll need to remove those trees, though, to do your project, so.
Yeah, that's right. For now, this is what we prepared, but we are going to have to look at how we're going to landscape this, okay. Yes.
Do you have a height for the screening you're proposing?
The height of the screen? I'm going to go back to the section to be specific. What we want to do is this retaining wall at this point is 4 feet from grade to the lower parking area. This is the railing, so we probably want the trees to be about, you know, the screen to conceal the cars here. So I would say 6 or 4 to 10 feet high.
So it's not intended to screen the building, just the parking?
Just the parking, yes.
Before we go any further, this is a public hearing, and I'd like to make a motion to open the public hearing. Second?
Second.
All in favor? Thank you. I'm sorry, go ahead.
Well, I've been through all the slides so far, so do you have any questions?
Christine, are there any variances required?
Yes. The variance we need is for building coverage, not development coverage. The maximum required is 30%, and we're at 31.7. And I can't seem to get it to fit unless I take the decks off. And I think decks, having individual outdoor spaces are important.
Have you gone to the CBA yet?
No.
That's the only variance?
We also, these decks, the decks in front will go into the prevailing setback. So I think there's going to be two. And they're all because of the decks.
You should probably do that. Don't go there.
Pardon?
You should go to the ZBA right away.
Okay.
The elevations where the building sort of steps out, is that,
yes.
Does that include the stick part that sticks out? Is that considered lot coverage or?
We included the total looking down.
Oh, okay.
As including the decks as a lot coverage.
Okay.
We did not, the only reason we said.
It's not actually the footprint?
No, we didn't.
Okay.
I have to clarify that, but I assume that it would be any impervious structure when you're looking down at the building, not necessarily what touches the grade, but.
Yeah,
Brian's not.
I don't know that either.
But the reason why it's set in is really to give more space to the driveway.
Yes, okay.
Just give a little more space there.
Yeah.
Is there any way to provide screening along the sides? The driveway goes right to the property line, so I suspect that it'd be difficult. Especially for the single family house to your, I guess, to the south or west.
Right here, this is the property where that five-story building is on this side.
That's the eight family, isn't it?
What?
No, that's the 59.
59.
59.
Verse
six,
oh,
to the south.
Gotcha, gotcha.
The south.
Eight, I think.
Six family house.
Yeah. You know,
that's
I'm,
one I'm thinking.
I'm going to have to go there. Right now, there is a driveway here. It's not as wide, and there are already trees here, and I think they're on their property.
Yeah.
We wanted to keep the driveway here for a lot of reasons. It seems to work better on this side than against this building that looks more like a house.
Mm-hmm. I agree with that.
Yeah, driveways are on both sides.
Just one side. We had an early scheme that had both sides and decided to just widen it and so we can limit the amount of impervious surface and traffic, and of course.
Yeah, I think that's better, and to have it on the apartment side is better.
Yeah. Okay.
That's a two-way drive or one-way?
Two-way.
I mean, can two cars pass each other?
In 16 feet. I've done it for many other projects.
Really?
I think it's
carefully.
It's been accepted as two-way, but it's not like a huge highway, you know. And also, you know, there are two spots in the street, and you want to keep them. You want to knock one out. So there's, you know, that's another reason for keeping the driveway where it is.
As always, the big issues are how this addresses the old curb. And from the photos, you couldn't really tell. Or I couldn't
tell.
What can be seen from there after the overgrowth is cleared is an important.
We can get that view, sure.
It's warranted.
Up and down.
Can you spend some of your money on the parking garage in the neighboring building?
Yeah,
because that parking garage is at the back of the 59 unit building is really one of the worst intrusions on the aqueduct, I think.
With the next building over.
Oh yeah, oh, yeah. It's really the worst.
The air conditioner is nice.
No, I don't have a picture of it.
Just to the north of your building is a.
You know, the building is pushed way back, and when I was looking at this plan, it almost looks like. Look how far back it is towards the aqueduct.
Well, yes, and there's the parking garage is just abuts the.
Right up against it?
Yeah, right against it.
We have a green space here. We have space here.
I know. It's
plenty of space.
That's
too.
Good.
Plants.
Yeah.
How wide is it?
Just 23 feet.
23 feet is for the landscaping at the back, or some of that for.
It's angled, but. It's this is the setback. It's required. I think it's 25. So we have like 23, and then up here we have more like 29.
Excellent.
Yeah. Have you seen Mr. Palmer's report, engineering report?
I haven't.
Thank you. How's that for on engineering on it?
Yeah, now respond.
Well, it's currently dated.
And have you been to the HRB?
Yeah, this is our first. We've only been to two meetings. One was early, just pre-submission, and then this is our first meeting at any board, official meetings.
Yeah. any board members have any further comments? This will be back, obviously, next month, so, if you wish.
You should go to ARB and zoning. You have to go to zoning board. It really can't be moved forward too fast on this and planning without the variances. So. Yeah.
Should we go to them first and then come back to you?
You have to. I mean, they can't approve it without the variances.
Okay.
Yeah, you should go to the ARB at the same time and get their feeling on the architect.
All right.
Yeah, that'd be good.
And if you can get some larger photographs from the aqueduct once the leaves clear, I think it'll be helpful.
It's a public hearing. Does anyone, Mavis?
I'm Mavis Kane. I'm president of the Knights of the Brooklyn Aqueduct. So it's a different hat I've got on. But right now, Madeline's property is beautifully screened from the aqueduct. I know her well, the Swedish lady that was living there. And one of the nice things about her house, which I admit needs to be taken down, but it was beautifully set back from Broadway, so you have a little bit of green before you're sort of plunked into building, and I was wishing that would be a little bit further back from Broadway. But one of the things about Madeline's property was that it's beautifully screened from the aqueduct. And it's hard for me to tell how thick the screening is in this plan, but it doesn't look to me as if it's anywhere near as green and lush looking as it currently is. So I would hope that we get as much screening as possible. And it's it's very, very close to our Tony's vegetable garden on the aqueduct. So he's the one who'll be most affected. But I knew it had to be done, but I would hope for as much screening as possible. Right now, you wouldn't even know there's a swimming pool there. You know, I happen to know there is one there, but the foliage around it is beautiful. So let's hope we can retain some of that.
Thank you.
The green look on the aqueduct.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think a, site survey, Christina, do you have a site survey that shows the trees, the existing? Okay, thank you.
But are there any trees, any specimen trees or anything that are near the back that are worth saving, or?
It's overgrown. We're going to have to go there.
Clean it up. You have to
examine it.
Okay.
Really there, it's hard to know.
Yeah, you should probably note any.
We'll look into that, yeah.
I don't think there's a willow tree there, maybe.
It might be something.
I don't see it.
Okay.
Maybe. I hope that.
It's a good idea.
Thanks.
Are you raising the grade back there at all with the retaining wall that you're proposing at the back?
Yes, we have to wait about 4 feet at the back wall of that open parking area.
Mm-hmm. Well, you're lowering the grade at the parking. You're not raising the grade towards the aqueduct, or are you?
Building a shelf sort of thing.
Yeah, it's like a shelf. This, because we have to get a fairly level area for parking, we have to fill this in, the retaining wall, but it's only about 4 feet high. But then we plan to plant this area and screen.
So the parking is in what relation, let's just say, to the aqueduct, if we take aqueduct at 0?
Raised.
The hill actually starts to flatten out in the last 25 feet. This is the parking in 25 feet. And there's about a drop of maybe a foot from the bottom of this retaining wall to the parking.
One of the things we were able to do with some of the other projects where the plantings that are actually on the Old Croton Aqueduct, subject to getting permission, some of those sometimes need some attention. So we've other applicants. Other applicants have agreed to seek permission from the state to do some maintenance where their property abuts the Old Croton Aqueduct. So if you're out there looking, doing a little tree survey or whatever for the back area,
might be good to extend it a little bit into the aqueduct property to see if there's things that would enhance the old Croton Aqueduct at the same time. Well, we don't know that yet. We've actually, all we've gotten is their commitment to seek it. But so far, I don't think anything's been done.
Parkway Drive.
What?
Parkway Drive, they got permission.
Okay.
Probably work on it.
Yes, well, we had one case that did work, so.
Any other comments from the board? If not, we'll see you next. We'll continue the public hearing to our next meeting if you have things to tell us then or whenever you're ready.
I think we will probably be there.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
Christina.
You have to use the mic.
I wanted to ask you a sort of awesome one.
Christina?
Item 6 on our agenda tonight is a pre-submission conference for site plan review to the Board of Trustees for proposed mixed-use development on property located at 364 Ashford Avenue. I don't know what Brian's up to.
Oh, yeah.
Brian, is 364 here?
What? In town hall.
So I'm curious, but I was looking at these drawings, and I see all the foundation. There's like a series of foundation things.
I don't know.
But there are no elevations.
Do you know this property?
I do. I buy my Christmas tree there.
You can't get off it? You can't get on it?
Can't get on cable.
You can now. According to, if you look at the...
It's going to have to build a ramp.
Well.
The hoist picks up the car.
No, but you can't. I don't know. You can't get out onto Ashford because you've got traffic coming. It's eight different ways.
It has to do with lights and everything. The timing, you can't make the traffic.
And Helen is one of the steepest streets in the village.
So you're not going to access off of here because actually it goes down. It's a very deep one. You've got this is a through street coming here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, right here.
Yeah. Excuse me, you must use your microphone, introduce yourself and the project.
Good evening, members of the board. Dan Collins from Hudson Engineering and Consulting, the engineer of the project. We're here to represent our client, the Google four-story mixed-use building located at the corner of Ashford Avenue and Southfield Avenue. The existing property is an approximately half-acre site with an existing 2.5-story multi-family building on it. Associated parking for the building as well as more spaces added for the rest of the lot being undeveloped. The portion of the park existing property along Ashford Avenue is actually located in the DT downtown transition zoning district, and everything from the line from here down is located in the OF-6 one-family residential zoning district. As previously mentioned, our client is proposing to construct a new four-story mixed-use building. This shows the outline of the building is here with the parking underneath. So the outline of the building comes around like such. When we just show the first floor, so we show our parking. I can't really speak too much for the architectural plans. The architect is not here right now. computer so I can show them to you as I get farther on. It's going to have a new four-story mixed-use building associated with parking and access drive. The building would consist of a 417 square foot office space on the parking on the lower level, the street level, and 3 floors of residential dwelling units above. These units would consist of 11 two-bedroom units and 6 one-bedroom units for a total of 17 units. Two of these units will actually be affordable housing units. The proposed parking lot is to be accessed from Ashford Avenue at the western side of the site, so you'd enter here, and then you'd exit down at the light at the intersection between Ashford, and I guess this is still Allen here, even though Allen's there. This is very confusing.
So that's the signalized intersection.
All the proposed parking will be on the street level. There are 15 spaces located directly underneath the building, with an additional 7 spaces located in the far corner, the far side of the property, for a total of 22 spaces. This meets the required spaces for the total of units, 17 units. All the provided parking is designed to serve both the proposed office and the proposed residential units above to help. The entire development, as you can see, is located within the DT zoning district, which was this line forward, and meets and exceeds all the village zoning requirements. In regards to stormwater design, I know we have not submitted these plans formally. We do have a design that we did put forth. We did not put a report together yet. We're waiting to get feedback from before we plan any further. However, the design is we're going to take all the impervious area. We have a couple of inlets. It's going to be captured via these inlets underneath the building, as well as a trench drain located at the entrance drive, which is right here. All this will be treated with an aqua swirl pre-treatment unit, which will get a lot of the solids out and the oil in the grid. From here, it will be conveyed to a 160-millimeter-foot, 42-inch pipe, which will control flows and discharge the control flows into Ashford Avenue, per the village standards. Once everything's submitted, obviously, once we've had everything put together, designed, and report done, we'll have everything submitted in the next
I think most of us know this site very well, and there's a reason that it hasn't been developed over the last 50 years. And the primary, I mean, it's topography for one thing, but that's probably the least of it. It's really traffic. How do you get cars onto the property, and if you got one on, how would you ever get it off? So I think...
Safely.
I think the key for me to be convinced that this is viable is to show us how in different times of day you can get cars on the property, off the property, into the flow of traffic, because there's all sorts of different flows going on at that.
Oh yeah, I came down the same this way to come over here, and this gets all backed up here, I can see that, and then these guys coming in and these guys coming across.
It all gets backed up and right across the front of your property so that you can't get in or out at times of day, and as you probably know, your client knows, the bridge is going to be renovated over the next 2 or 3 years, and so it'll be down to one lane there at best. So it's going to be challenging, and I think we're going to be very careful to make sure anything that happens here, is not making a bad situation worse in terms of traffic flow, because it's really how do you get on and off going different directions out of this property is not obvious.
The OF6 section, is that bordered on a street on the...
Allen Street.
That's Allen.
No, I mean, there is a street that comes in from Broadway, but that... from Ashford, but that's by the dry cleaner. That's not there. I'm just trying to remember. But the other side, over by the OF6, is that what's on the border of the OF6? On the.
I'm just confused. This is Allen Street here. Allen Street. can see it. Where Saddlefield is, comes across.
So where is Pearl Street?
You can see it here.
Pearl Street's on the property.
Oh, I see. So it doesn't border on the property.
No, you can see it here on the site.
There's a house next to the six zone, isn't there? Isn't that white and green house up the hill?
Well, there's a florist there. There's a veterinary. Up the hill, there's a new house that was built a few years ago. Up Allen Street. Yeah, Chucky Pavement did that.
Okay, so yeah, I mean, I was just wondering if there's any access from Pearl Street, but I guess not.
And so did, I have to ask, was access from Allen Street considered?
Not yet. We were trying to not develop within the OF6 district. We're trying not to go through this area, try to keep it undisturbed, and try to keep everything within the DT district, keep it on that side. That's not do anything, bring anybody around this.
But Javier, what you're talking about is whether you could access,
traffic, yeah.
Access it from...
Yeah, whether you build there or you just get your cars and they sit on the roof or whatever. I mean, basically that... Yeah.
Yes.
I mean, it just seems, you know, again, for safety and traffic, and I can't imagine not having right turn only or something coming out of those driveways that you're proposing. I mean, for people to make a left there just seems...
It's impossible.
Impossible and, you know, recipe for accidents. All right. What's that?
So that's why we're here.
I mean, I know Allen is not, you know, I mean, there's a residential component, so, you know, it's a steep street and so forth, but I think once you get up there, it might be, it seems from the topography to be a little more level.
Because they don't own this piece of land. To go in.
But this is super steep here.
They have that leg over there.
Yeah, this, we own all the way through all the town.
I mean, there's an existing light where the exit's shown.
Yeah, this is, yeah, we did that on purpose. We'll try to line it up with this light that currently exists here.
Yeah, but they're coming around the corner. That's, you're just putting, making a head-on collision.
I agree, it's a challenge.
Brian's going to say something. Microphone, please.
Traffic study.
Sorry.
Mr. Chairman, the property that runs behind the 364 Ashford address and goes up to Allen is in a different zone. It's in the OF6 zone, and part of its development has to be for residential purposes. It's not, cannot be a driveway or a parking lot to access a commercial property.
Thank you.
Is that something that one could get a variance for, presumably?
If someone chooses to go to the zoning board, it's a possibility. But right now, that's property, again, as in 75 Main Street, property in two separate zones.
Right. Mm. So, sorry, just to be clear, if they put a driveway from Allen Street, then there would need to be that would not be permitted to access commercial.
It's a residential zone. Its purpose is to be for residential use. You cannot have a secondary use as a driveway into something else. It would turn into a possible parking area, turn into something else. And that's not permitted unless there's another primary structure to permit such a use.
So if there is residential use in addition to the driveway, and except the driveway continues past that residential use,
there
then
is
it's
a
permitted.
Possibility.
Okay.
Now that secondary lot, OF6, has a steep slope concern.
Yeah.
And it's not physically large enough to be a residence at this time.
Right. Okay, thank you.
So it's sort of landlocked and not useful.
We are coming up on Christmas.
Yeah. Well, I don't know what to tell you, except I think this is a very challenging project. And
Mr. Chairman, I think should we require that before they come back, they actually undertake a parking study,
traffic study.
Yeah.
To see
yeah.
how and actually yeah. make sure the driveway grade and all that's planned out. I don't know if you've done that already. And have a expert traffic engineer look at it. We have a
traffic engineer that we would then bring on to look it over.
It's a question, how do you access the property and how do you egress out of the property at different times of day?
And it's more than just, it's inconvenient. We have fire trucks that have to access it too. So if they can't get in and there's a fire, this is not going to proceed. So the traffic analysis, which shows times of day when the worst sections of times of day we're trying to get into the lot or anything else like that, that kind of information is, I think, the number one information that we need to be able to evaluate the project.
Sure. So I think you have, as the chairman used to say, you have your work cut out for you here. And we look forward to seeing you back with the traffic study or in any other information that you wish to share with us. So I think we'll keep this as a pre-submission because we're a long way from being ready to go further. Thank you. The last item on the agenda is a pre-submission conference for site plan review for proposed renovations and additions to single-family residence at 74 Maple and new two-family residence located at the DeVoe Street end of the property. This is another interesting one. Have you looked at this one?
I did right before the meeting.
They're building a house on the back of a single family lot.
Subdivision? Two lots? Two zoning lots already?
No.
They got a subdivision.
It's not legal size.
It's got variances.
They've been to the zoning board.
They granted
zoning boards, no. The zoning board sent them here.
Here's other required.
Just like the flow chart says. look at the flow chart, Darius, will you? How many times am I going to have to explain this?
We need the big illustrated flow chart that says little guys walking along the path and stuff.
Good evening.
Consistency.
Good evening. My name is Steve Seacon. I'm an architect for the applicant who has recently purchased a property at 74 Maple. I don't know if you had an opportunity to visit the site. It's characterized in the R1. It's bounded by DeVoe Street on the south and Maple on the north. Currently, there is one building here on the north end, and we've been to the zoning board who refers to come to planning and get your opinion and suggestions on similar matters. The site has a fairly good incline falling downhill towards the north. There is almost 10 to 12 foot parking spaces for the three total units. So we have the requirement of two per unit. Unfortunately, due to current site constraints, there are a number of variances that we do need. Some are already existing because it's existing non-conformity, and then some minor ones for sky exposure and so forth. The new house. The alignment is proposed to match the adjacent houses. The height is also conforming in terms of the elevation and maximum ridges.
This is one single lot?
It's one single lot. It's not a subdivision.
Okay.
It's too small for a subdivision.
But
do you have the drawings?
Mr. Cook, are two buildings, is a new building allowed on one single lot?
After reviewing the code several times, there is a section of the code that says no accessory dwelling.
What you said is no subdivision. How can it not be? That was the first thing I thought of.
Because there's not enough land to have a legal subdivision. You can't. So, well,
legally, I don't know. So this is problematic unless you're subdividing. The variance is for the lot sizes.
Yeah.
You can't put a single family and a two family home on the same lot. Can't do it.
And you're not supposed to subdivide and create.
You can try.
Yeah.
If I mean, well, how big would the lots be if you subdivided? Would it be conforming?
No.
I think my understanding is, and you can correct me, that they would be more or less conforming to the neighborhood. The fact is, apparently, that most every lot on those two streets is non-conforming by history.
Are they owned by the same people? Are they one lot or are they separate zoning lots?
This is one lot.
The other ones are two separate
MDR
ones.
Zone.
Yeah, that's legal.
Yeah.
But if I can just show like a figure ground of the neighborhood just to go through.
Just a question while you're doing that. You're saying that the existing building is fairly dilapidated?
Yes.
Why wouldn't you want to just build a bigger one building, you know, a single?
Yeah, townhouses are permitted there. I mean, that looks like some
you
sort
You could
of
build three units or four units, correct?
You could do two or three family dwellings. You can't do multi-family houses.
Three family.
Right, we have the acreage.
And that you wouldn't need a variance for that.
You could do a three family home.
Three family home.
We have explored that.
Uh-huh, okay.
First preference for the owner is to have two freestanding units.
Okay.
If it's, again, permissible and approval.
Okay.
Just also in terms of traffic, you know, being separated, parking, you know, spreading it out, being less mitigated by having two entrances.
How many square feet is a lot?
It says right here, 7,500. 7,575.
A little over 7,500 square feet. So, my way to make it makes more than that.
Okay.
Okay.
But doesn't this have to go to the zoning? I mean, how can we review it if it's. And I know they said about it here, but this is. It's not to go anywhere. It's illegal. To have two uses, a single family and two family house on one lot, you can't do it without a subdivision.
And you can't subdivide.
You can get subdivided if you can get the variances. You need, 1,250 feet variances for each lot? I doubt you. Maybe you'd get it. I don't know.
Are you allowed to have two structures on a lot? Like, let's say they were both.
Yeah, an accessory use. You can have an accessory structure.
It's not.
No, I think,
no, it's not allowed.
I think that's what you. Right, you can't have an accessory dwelling.
Right.
It can be a garage or something.
It was so noted in the original zone.
Yeah, no, I would like to revisit that sometime.
If it says accessory dwelling unit, MDR1, no, not allowed. Accessory buildings, accessory parking you can have.
So it's not permitted.
Right.
They have to go for a variance.
That's good, you try to subdivide, you ask for subdivision, you get an area variance, or you get a use variance.
More like a use variance.
Yeah, you're not gonna get a use variance, you gotta subdivide. If you think it fits in the neighborhood, the zoning board needs to look at it and see if it fits in the neighborhood. What happens first, the subdivision and the variance, I mean, it sort of happens together. But they gotta see, are they willing to do that and make smaller lots for these two uses? And then you can decide whether you agree with that too for a subdivision. Otherwise, you're not legal.
Yeah, subdivision applications come to this board.
Right.
And basically, the principle of this board in granting subdivision is not to create substandard lots, period. I don't know where you go from there, basically, that's.
I think the zoning board's feeling was that the neighborhood is such that every lot there is non-conforming, and this would not create any burden on the neighborhood.
Right, it's actually contextual.
So where is your building on this plan?
We're here.
Oh, I see, okay.
And what I guess I'm trying to describe is that, quite a few.
Which one are you again? Just I didn't see you, you know what, okay.
The one with the empty.
Right, so you basically want to create what's just to your left, except without the two tax lots, the two properties.
Right, and you got the other, nearby properties, because it's so highly non-conforming. And right now, it's an abandoned lot. It looks like, a smile of missing teeth. And, everyone gets used to the fact that it's overgrown and no one's using it, but in fact, it's really not. What we're proposing is really an infill type of project to make it more contextual, yet it's more not conforming because as the regulations
are written. So did the ZBA want us to see if there was viable parking solutions before they looked at it again for a subdivision variance?
Sorry, Mr. Cook, if he makes a walkway between the two buildings, a covered walkway,
closed.
Then it's one building.
We have an architect that you could work with. if you have a year or two.
There's your three-family house.
So you just put a covered walkway between the two buildings, and you have one building.
Don't do it.
Don't do it.
Please don't do it.
Or an air conditioning duct.
we're trying to do something that's.
No, I'll tell you. I'm sympathetic with the intent. And I can imagine that it's completely contextual. It's just a matter of figuring out what the process is since it's just basically illegal. I don't know what the mechanism is.
I don't either.
I don't object to it.
If it's a subdivision, when it comes to you, you're supposed to see that it complies with zoning. It's an interesting problem. I haven't come across this one.
Yeah, there are situations where you may have a slight substandard lot, but you're creating, 8,000 square feet, I think you said?
7,600.
So let's say 8, 4,000 square foot lots, give or take.
Those lines that are there on all the adjacent properties,
yeah,
the split.
Those are split. But that one's through, but of course it doesn't have a building, right? If you look at the other through property over to the
so
left.
So if you look at the average.
That's the same condition you have.
Yeah. So the majority of properties on this block are subdivided, and that's really, it seems to me, what you would be proposing, to match the majority of your neighbors with the subdivision.
That wasn't really what was contemplated, because the idea was first to have the three families on one property, but if it's more palatable to perhaps subdivide it because it's more conforming, lot.
Less non-conforming.
I mean, could you...
I mean, what is the least, I guess, what is the least, feels like the least...
You're talking me into it, but I haven't come across, but obviously, if the zoning board sent it back here in its great wisdom, maybe they're pointing to the idea that you need to do a subdivision. That's the only reason I could, I know they didn't say that right up front, but basically, they couldn't, what would be their basis for approving it? I mean, so they said, okay, go see if the planning board has a better idea. And the idea of a subdivision to create two substandard lots, I guess you'd need to do a survey of the properties in the area to talk about the lot sizes that they all have, and then show a subdivision line with the utilities and all that, and parking and all that, and then
this is from
see
the
if you can get a subdivision approval.
Clear.
I mean, if you own the public, if their interest was to rent the other one, then you still own them. So you rent the other one. So having,
But your parking would have to stay with each property, correct?
Yeah, each property.
You'd have to park themselves.
Yeah.
Lot.
And someday you'd be able to sell it off. Obviously, that's an advantage. People give your options that way. But I would do a survey because normally the board shouldn't approve creating substandard lots. The only case you can make is there's all these other substandard lots, so.
Yeah, and I think that's not an unreasonable case in this case.
Yeah.
Do we want to do a site visit?
I have a quick question, I'm sorry. You're showing 2.5-story frame building.
We can do it ourselves. He did see the key.
But it doesn't look like what's shown there in 74 Maple.
Yeah, it's just perfectly reasonable.
This is right now absent the new house.
Sure, sure, but you, maybe that's including the patio? I guess that's what it is. You're also adding second floor addition off,
correct.
Which is that?
Correct.
Okay.
All
right.
So is there a lot coverage issue too?
Yeah.
Imagine.
No problem.
Same survey. If they all have substandard lot coverage, same condition. You'd need to evaluate the size of the lot, size of the building, coverage on it, and everything else in the neighborhood to make a case that it could be subdivided, and you should be entitled to variances for setback. I don't know what all the different things could be in there, but building coverage.
Well, I think setback, my understanding, I didn't look at the lot, was that the setbacks in the street are... would not meet, but and that's why the parking was put around back, so they didn't put it in front.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Is this neighborhood from the 50s? Is it the 40s or something?
30s, 20s.
Really?
You sure there's no subdivision plat file?
No. I haven't checked with our attorney. I don't know.
I think that was Javier. That was your point, that this is how it was developed.
Well,
looking
at all those properties,
it looks like it. Yeah.
Yeah, the development scheme doesn't seem off, but
maybe the Historical Society would have
a Google map.
Would a single three-family dwelling be conforming?
Yeah, I think so. As long as the size, I think it's 5,000 square feet, three-family. Yeah.
So just a thought that would be the path of least resistance.
Yeah. Well,
we don't want to do that.
It could be more approvable, yet more detrimental. So, I mean, it's...
Yeah, it's less consistent with the neighboring properties,
right?
Yeah.
So, I mean, that's part of why we're...
Probably have a sky exposure plane problem, too.
Well, here it is.
NPR1, yeah.
So, what's the decision?
I think...
I think you've been given some direction. I think, this is unusual and... I think rather than just send you back to the zoning board, which they don't want to see you right now anyway, I think if you follow some of the suggestions you received tonight, we'd be willing to continue the discussion.
Is it clear what our suggestions are?
Well, I think we as
Because it's not clear to me. I mean,
I thought the idea was that actually the path that seems like it has the most daylight is doing a subdivision, and that if you can, as Bright was saying, if you can document that this pattern is like pretty pervasive in this neighborhood, then you'll probably have a sympathetic.
But so we would recommend to the.
I think
zoning.
We would recommend to the zoning.
That's how it works.
Yeah,
that's how the chart works. The chart.
But you would have to subdivide.
Yeah.
So you would have a subdivision application, site plan application. Then you'd go to the zoning board for the whatever variances you would need, whether it be lot size, lot coverage, whatever. You'd go through the zoning analysis.
And they would have to function. You'd lay it out as two functioning independent lots.
Right. The sites would have to park themselves.
Okay. Good.
And no covered walkways.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I move we adjourn.
Use the hammer.
Second.
Oh, I don't want to use the gavel.